I call again a mutually exclusive event. Now when we say an event is mutually exclusive, when we say an event is mutually exclusive, what we really mean is that the event has no intercept. So when we say the event has no intercept, let's say for instance we have an event A and an event B. So in the case, if these two events are mutually exclusive, it means there will be no intercept. Therefore, probability of A or B is equal to your probability of A plus your probability of B. When there is no common term in between the element of what? A, and there is an element of what? B. Then we call such an event a mutually exclusive event, and this is the what? The formula. So what if in a situation whereby it's not mutually exclusive event, not mutually exclusive what? Event. In the case whereby we have it as not mutually exclusive what? Event, we are going to be having this as a, in this case now, what this means exactly is that there is an intercept. There is an what? Intercept. And once there is an intercept, if you are also considering probability of event A and event B, probability of A or B will be equal to probability of A plus probability of what? B minus probability of what? A intercept B. Simply because there is an intercept. And when there is an intercept, you what? Relate that to what? Was a mutual, not mutually exclusive event. In the case of mutually exclusive, no intercept. When it's not mutually exclusive, there is an intercept. Now we move on to this example on the board. So let's take a look at that example together. Two dice, one red and one blue are thrown together. We have two dice. Let's assume that these are my dice. Okay, I have two dice. And one red and one blue are thrown together. So I throw the two dice. Construct a what? A probability sample space diagram to illustrate the outcome. Find the probability that at least one of the dice will show a 6. And the sum of the scores is 3 or 5. The sum of the score is 8 or even double. Wow. In this case, I'm having two dice. How would you draw out your what? Your sample space. To draw out your sample space, you draw this fantastic table. So let us go move together. To what? Evaluate your sample space. All you just need to do, okay, is to draw out your table. So to consider my table, let me have this way. For the first die, I'm going to be having either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. That's for the first die. The outcome that you can have for the first die, you write it out. The outcome you can have for the second die is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then 6. Now, how would you draw out your sample space? Now, when you throw the first one, okay, there's tendency that it can be 1, 1. There's tendency that it can be 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4. That means you can have 1 and 4. 1 and 5, 1 and 6, 2 and 1, 2 and 2, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, 2 and 5, 2 and 6. I'm done with that. We move on to the next one. 3 and 1, 3 and 2, 3 and 3, 3 and 4. So it's going to be 4. Okay, 3 and 4, 3, 4, 3, 5, 3, 6. So you do that to this 4, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, 4, 4, 4, 5, 4, 6. So we have 4, 6. So here's going to be what? 5, 1, 5, 2, 5,3, 5,4, 5,5, 5, 6. So this is going to be what? 6, 1, 6, 2, 6, 3, 6, 4, 6, 5, 6, 6. Now, this gives me the sample space diagram for that question. So let us go back to the question. Two dice, one red and one blue, are thrown together, I've done that. Draw the probability sample space. This gives me my probability what? Sample space. Now, the next question says that find the probability that at least one of the dice will show a 6. At least one of the dice. Do not forget that at least means that at least one. You must have one, but you can have more than one. Now, you go back to your what? Your table. To what? Check out for the one that has at least one. Oh, fantastic. This has at least one. This has at least one. This have 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 at least one. Oh, this also have at least one. This also have. This also have. This also have. This also have. So if I look around the game, no one has at least one. Now, you will not write out your value. Probability of at least one. Probability of at least one. How would you do that? Probability of at least one. So let's clean up this. Probability of at least one. Let's clean this up. Probability of at least one. Probability of at least one. So the probability of at least one in this case now, probability of at least one dice will show a 6 would now be equals to, so you have to go back to your table. You have to go back to your table. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So the total number of value with at least 6 is what? 11. Then you go back to your what? Answer to write what? 11. Over, what is the total number of outcomes we have here? So by the time you evaluate this, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. By the time you count it all, the total outcome you have is what? 36. The total outcome you have here is going to be what? 36. When you count the whole box, one after the other in this box. So you are going to be having what? 36. So all you just need to do is to go back to the question, okay? And write this as 11 over what? 11 over 36. And that gives us our final answer. And that's all. So let's move on to the next one. This is the A part of the question. Let's look at the B part of the question. And what does the B part of the question say? What does the B part of the question say? It says, the sum, determine the probability that the sum of the score is 3 or 5. The sum of the scores is 3 or 5. Then you have to go to your table. Back to your table. Sum of the scores is 3. You need to go back to your table. Now let's check out for the sum of the score is 3. 1 plus 1, 2. Oh, 1 plus 3 is 3. I'll circle this. Okay, now, wow. 2 plus 1 is what? 3. So let me check. 3 plus 1 is not giving me 3. Because this is only 2 that will give me a 3. So now let's take a look at all 5. Let's take a look at the one that will give you 5. Oh, 1 plus 4, 5. I'm going to circle this. 3 plus 2, 5. I'm going to circle this. 3 plus 2, 5. I'm going to circle this. And 4 plus 1, 5. When you look around again, there's no value that can give you a sum of 5. Then go back to your what? To your formula. Probability of obtaining a sum of scores of 3 or 5 is going to be written as a probability of sum of score, sum of what score is what, 3 or what, 5, will be written as probability of 3 plus, because all in probability means for probability of what, sum of 5. Probability of sum of score is 3 and probability of sum of score is what, 5. Now, in this case now, the probability of sum of scores is 3. Is what? 1, 2. So by the time you do this now, 2, 1, 2, the required outcome is 2 over 36. You are done with that. So you move on to the next one, all 5. So when this is the sum of score is 5, is 1, 2, 3, 4. Fantastic.
So 4 over what? Over 36.
So by the time you evaluate this, you have nothing less than 6 over what? 36. And that is equal to what? 1 over 6. And that is all. And on last note, probability that the sum of score is 8 or even double. Probability that the sum of score is what? 8 or even double. Now let's take a look at what that statement means. Let's take a look at what that statement means. I'm going to be managing my ball. All I just need you to do is to listen, okay? All I need you to do is to do what? Is to listen. Now, in this case now, probability that sum of score is 8. Sum of score is 8. Sum of score is 8. That means probability that sum of the score, sum of score is what? Is 8. Or even double. We have to look at, let's look at the sum of score is 8. Let's look at the sum of score is 8. What would we have? Sum of score is 8. Let's look at the sum of score is 8. Now when the sum of score is 8, we need to take a look at it critically. I'm going to be having this, number 1. I'm going to be having this, 5 plus 3 is 8. 4 plus 4 is 8. 5 plus 3 is 8. 6 plus 3 is 8. So when you look around, there is no other value that can give me what? 8. So in the case of sum of score is 8, we have what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you go back to your what formula to write 5 over what? 5 over what? Over 36. Plus even double. What even double means? The double must be an even number. So if the double is to be an even number, let us go back to our table. The double must be an even number. So let us go back to our table to rectify that. Okay? If it's an even number, okay? Let's look at this. Oh, 2, 2 is an even number. Okay? 4, 4 is an even number. Okay? 6, 6 is an even number. Fantastic. So we have what? 1, 2, 3. Those are the only two even what? Doubles. We have 3 even doubles. We have 2, 2, 4, 4 and what? 6, 6. So you go back to your what? Your formula to write what? 3 over 36. 3 over what? 36. But you observe something. You observe that during the course of what? Evaluating those two things from your what table, there is an intercept. Look at the 6. 2 give us 8, 5 3 give us 8, 4 4 give us 8, 3 2 give us 8, and 2 6. But when we are considering even double, 2 2, 4 4, and 6 6, this is the intercept. Now, since I have intercept, so those two events, is not mutually exclusive. And as a result of that, I'm going to be having a subtraction of. How many intercepts do I have? 1 out of the what? The total. So by so doing, this is 8 minus 1. That gives you what? 7 over what? 36. And that gives us the final answer to that. And you're done. That is how to go about what we call a mutually exclusive event and not mutually exclusive what? Event. Let's take one more example to understand this better. Alright, good. We shall be looking at these questions together. And the question says that a fair coin and a fair die are thrown at the same time. You take a fair coin, one fair coin and a die are thrown at the same time. List all the possible outcomes by making a possibility sample space. To make a possibility sample space, by drawing out my table. So I'm going to be having 1. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 for the case of a die. Because when you throw a die, there's a tendency that you can either have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, either of the 6 values. And for the case of a coin, there's a tendency that you can add towards a head or a tail. Because when you have a coin, this side can either be the head or the tail. So it has two sides, the head and the tail. Now, to combine your what sample space. All you need to do is to write 1, comma what h, 2, comma what h, 3, comma h, 4, comma h, 5, comma h, and 6, comma h. And in this case, now it's going to be what? 1, comma t, 2, comma t, 3, comma t, 4, comma t, and then 5, comma t, then finally 6, comma t. So this gives all the probability or sample space for this question. And this part of the question says that what is the probability of getting a 5 comma h? All you need to do is to go back to your what? Go back to your sample space there. 5 comma h, the only 5 comma h can have is just for this. Out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So you have 1 over 12. And that gives us the final answer to that question. And II says that, what is the probability of obtaining even number? Comma 18. In the case of even number comma 18, let's take a look at even number comma 18. 1. Even number comma 18. 2. This is not it. 3. So in this case, I'm going to be adding 3 over what? 12. This is equal to what? 1 over 4. So at this junction, I've been able to do what? Throughout my sample space, I've been able to do what? Determine my probability of 5 comma what? H. And I've been able to do what? Determine the even number comma